Ocean Foundation has been supporting coastal restoration since 2008. But through our Blue Carbon Calculator, our Seagrass Grow program, we're providing people with the opportunity to offset their carbon footprint through the restoration and conservation of seagrasses. These projects are typically very expensive though and time consuming, so we aggregate the donations over time, and then once we have an appropriate amount, we will deploy those resources at a site like this. I can't stress enough the importance of site selection. Now, there's a lot of seagrass out there that could be theoretically restored, but if you're not careful about where you do it, those projects typically fail.
Ocean Foundation has done a great job bringing experts to the site, identified those sites and prioritized those sites that needs immediate restoration.
So it's really important to work with the best professionals in the field in order to kind of pick the spots that are going to be successful in the long term. Manuel, our trainer, is one of the true pioneers in the field as far as the ability to do this work successfully.
Well, seagrass is extremely important to protect the shoreline. You know, that's the first line of defense for hurricanes, storm. You know, they buffer the water. Without that, you know, you get erosion all over the coastline, which is a big problem nowadays. You see, there was no seagrasses, right? What they will do is will hit the shoreline and they will start eroding and taking all the sand away. And then will be cloudy water, you know, and that shoreline eventually will be lost. So we will lose all the beaches, you know, that people like to go. Animals not only live on seagrasses, they also eat them. That's why we call it, for example, turtle grass. Turtle do eat salacia, that's a scientific name. Turtles eat them, manatee eats them, even little fish eat them internally. Sometimes they eat what's on top of the plant, which we call them epiphytes. But yeah, a lot of animals eat on seagrasses.
Manuel has a lot of experience on what he's doing on seagrass bass restoration. Over 10 years ago, he came to the reserve and gave us a workshop, and I was a student then. So I can say that he is really committed to this work, and he really wants to have a success project here in Puerto Rico.
Puerto Rico has experienced a lot of intense storms throughout its history, but with climate change, these hurricanes are strengthening. Hurricane Maria in 2017 was one of the strongest, if not the strongest hurricane to ever hit Puerto Rico in recorded history.
Ocean Foundation identified with us the need of restore those habitats that was damaged with the pass through Hurricane Maria. The impact on those habitats really affect our ecosystems here. If we don't act as the Ocean Foundation is doing right now, we could lose more habitats at the end.
You know, through these kind of capacity building workshops and restoration demonstrations, others around Puerto Rico and the world really can learn how to use these techniques in their own projects. So that way we can essentially have a multiplier effect, right?
I work in Bahia Puerto Mosquito in Vieques, and we also suffered the heat of Hurricane Maria, and our seagrasses also suffer a lot. So if we learn how to reproduce them and how to monitor the progress of these seagrasses, we may be gonna be able to do this type of work and reproduce it in other areas of Puerto Rico like Vieques.
Our methodology called compressed succession really kind of puts the gas pedal, if you will, on nature's ability to restore itself. What we're doing is we're bringing in pioneer species that grow very quickly to stabilize the sediment, prevent further erosion, and then the thalassia, the turtle grass, the climax species here, which stores the most amount of carbon, will naturally overtake the pioneer species and allow, you know, these kind of ecosystem services to be restored. Seagrass meadows play a vital role as nurseries for young fish, places that they can hide and feed. Without these seagrass meadows, the fisheries would be far less productive and the economy would suffer as a result.
The local community here in Salinas is mainly based on fishermen. There's a lot of fishermen here. Those guys, without the seagrass, they won't have any fish. But they don't really know that seagrasses are the one producing the juvenile of those fish that they are eventually eating or selling.
Coastal ecosystems provide one of our best lines of defense against strengthening hurricanes. They attenuate or soften waves. They prevent erosion. They improve water quality. They provide habitat for fisheries and for other animals. The turtles, the manatees, they all depend on these things. And so does this community, not only from a fishing perspective, but also from a tourism perspective. So through this kind of work, we can help restore the quality and integrity of these coastal ecosystems, which are one of our best forms of natural infrastructure. The Ocean Foundation is keen on working with the best of the best in order to maximize the utility of our donors' funds. We want to make sure that we hire the best people to design these projects so that they are not undone.
I'm very grateful for the job and the work the Ocean Foundation is doing here in the Caribbean. I hope that they continue working in habitat restoration and creating this legacy to the next generations in the island is very important for us. And I know Ocean Foundation will success on this.